playing with clay is so malleable. So I just got hooked. My family or friends at the time didn't know any potters or any ceramicists, that kind of thing. So they were just like, oh, it's probably better if you get a more stable job.
I first spent 2 months in a very small pottery town in Italy with incredibly skilled and patient teachers.
The teacher was really, he really wanted to like immerse us in Stoke history, because that's a really important part of ceramic history in the UK.
Last year I found out that my great-great-granddad and all of his brothers worked in the potteries of Stoke in the 1920s.
And there's this place called Gladstone Pottery Museum, and it's basically like a living pottery. And you just walk around it, and it really shows you like what people's jobs were and kind of the environment that they worked in.
On his death certificate, it says he's a saga glosser.
The saga loaders, or the people that like put the sagas into the kilns, they would sometimes have to go into the kilns whilst they were like boiling hot to like save on energy. You know, so they'd be made to go into like, I don't know what temperature, but like super hot temperatures to unload and then load again. So basically the pottery could save on fuel. And it was just like grueling work, like really hardcore.
I'm curious to know what they would have thought about the work that they were making. There's a whole century of history between us, but we're using the same materials and processes.
People go where it's cheap for the rent, but then they exclude everyone that's living there in so many ways.
Yeah, definitely. The access barriers aren't just financial. It's about who has access to learning, who's teaching, and how it's contextualised. Ultimately, it's a decolonising practice.
Maybe some people won't be interested, but there might be two or three people that really are and don't feel they're able to approach that space. So I haven't really seen that kind of, you know, the drudgery of the master student or master apprentice vibe. It's always been a very friendly, warm environment where the focus is on learning and helping each other. Because I think apprenticeships can be a really beautiful thing, you know. Someone thinks their role is greater than the other, which actually there is a balance there, you know. You're obviously teaching someone and obviously someone's learning from you, but that person is also helping you, like, run your studio. Learn so much from making something 100 times. I think there's a certain stage of doing things. It's like, you make a lot of work, you make a lot of mistakes, you train your eye to be able to see these things. And then maybe, because your eye is trained and also your hands are then trained, you can then make those one-off pieces that actually work.
I love how easy clay is to form and the breadth of what you can do with it. Its texture is so close to that of the body.
Oh, it's really hard to explain, but you know when you look at something and then you can't feel anything else in the room? You know, you look at something, you're like, ooh. And you just, it's like a moment that you have with that object that you're just like, yeah, that's, you just notice something about it. Whether it's the colour, the form, or the pattern, or whatever it is, and you're just like, yeah, that's really nice.
So much of working with sculpture and pottery for me is about intuition and really connecting to the pot and the materials that I'm working with.
Because I'm not really in, like, I want my pots to be used, I don't want them to be looked at. So for me, that's really important to look at the kind of functionality of that. And also the fact that they are so handmade, there's no way of getting around it, you know.
Yeah, going back and learning some of the more technical skills of repetitive throwing has informed my practice in ways that I just could never have imagined.
And kind of for me, the reduction firings are kind of like a stepping stone to the soda firings. And soda firing is where you have portholes in the kiln and you spray the soda into the kiln. And the soda reacts with the silica in the clay and creates like a glass, like a glaze, basically. And that's you know, you get so many different results out of that. You know, you can have, you know, two pots that are exactly the same in different places of the kiln and they look completely different. So in a way, the kiln is kind of taking away a lot of some of the choice.
It's a really powerful and resonant transformation from earth to stone. And I think you can't help but be mesmerised by it and the hybridity and magic.
When I talk about like putting things into the kiln and then being completely changed, it's like because they go through such a massive journey of heat to change them into what they are. That's when it always makes me laugh when people are like, is this oven safe? I'm like, yeah, it's literally been to hell back.
Thank you.